thank you for being here. My name is Trish. I do know all of you, so I feel a little guilty to say thank you for coming, but I really appreciate you coming out on a Sunday afternoon. There was nothing better to do, I know. So we're going to learn about money today. We're going to learn about how money comes in and how money goes out. And we have some experts in the audience, which is very helpful in case we get wound up or get mixed up on something, because I don't claim to be an expert.
And neither will I.
I don't think Robyn will claim to be an expert either. Just for those of you who might be tuning in, my name is Trisha Crain. I am the executive director of the Alabama School Connection, which is a news site devoted to covering K-12 education in Alabama. And as part of that group, that Alabama School Connection umbrella, we're hosting this Education Matters group. And it's sort of an experiment. It's designed to cross lines, you know, if you're not in PTO, or if you're not in public school, or if you don't have kids, or if you have grandkids, you know, everybody's welcome. Education matters to all of us. That's the one thing that I can say that we're all here for, because education matters. A couple of housekeeping items. Mr. Fulton, thank you for the donuts today. Thank you to Robyn's Church, the Beloved Community Church, for the coffee. Feel free to get up and get down as many times as you need to. This is going to be a real casual discussion. Robyn has some information to present. I'm going to jump in a couple times and present a couple things. And then you can certainly ask questions during the presentation. What we're going to try to refrain from doing here is holding a lot of commentary, okay? So we have these little rules, and I will read them out now. The only rules we have relate to how we conduct our conversations. We will be respectful of others' opinions, even if we disagree. I don't think that will be a problem with this group. We will focus on issues, refraining from using political language. We will use factual information when presenting to other group members. We will refrain from using partisan language or blaming any issue on any political party. That's the way we're used to communicating in Alabama, and that's the challenge. And the challenge for this is to have deliberative discussion, right? I love that word, deliberative, because you have to be deliberate when you're deliberating. And so you have to be deliberate in refraining from blaming things on people or parties, okay? These are all of our issues. Everything we're going to talk about affects all of our lives on one level or another. We will refrain from attaching actions or issues to any particular person. Also a very difficult thing to do. It's fine to say Senator Marsh's plan, okay? Or, you know, Senator Chambliss's plan, all right? But what we don't want to say is that doggone dirty rat so-and-so. I'm not attaching a name there, you notice. But and we don't want to say this man is the most brilliant person in the universe and here's his plan. You know, we don't want to bleed each other, okay? I think that through deliberative discussion, we kind of reach those conclusions anyway. And the final rule is we will seek a better understanding of education issues that impact our community's children. And that is what I believe brings us all to the table. I would love for everybody to introduce themselves, but what we might do is take a break after about an hour, and then we'll have an opportunity to introduce ourselves, because I know the various perspectives. There's a lot of diversity in this room, and I appreciate that. So, without further ado, Robyn Hyden from Alabama Arise. She's an organizer with Alabama Arise. It says so right here on her slide, but she's an organizer.
Yes.
And she's going to talk about this. Does everybody have a copy of it? I can hand some out. And Robyn is going to start us out. Oh, and restrooms. Will you mention where restrooms are?
Two restrooms down here. They're both unisex. And yeah, please feel free to get some water or coffee or get a bit of brown. So this is my church, and we're glad to have you guys here. And you're also welcome to stay later for our service, which is 6 p.m. on Sunday nights. But that's the end of my morning for my church. So Trish mentioned I'm not an expert. Why I'm here is that my organization produces a lot of expert policy information. And we've released this tax and budget handbook. I think a lot of you already got a copy of it before when I came to the Education Matters roundtable. And I brought more copies today because I'm going to refer to specific things in here while I'm talking. The goal is really, I'm going to show you some slides that are from this book and show you how to find the information so that you can take this home and have it with you and you'll actually use it. We printed up like 15,000 of these things. We want people to read them. We don't just want them sitting on, you know, your shelf. So it's very timely because, you know, the Alabama state legislature is still struggling to pass a general fund budget. And so I want to talk today about what goes into the education trust fund and the general fund budgets, and how the tax revenue is generated, and why they're having an issue filling such a small budget hole. So, the woman, well, let me tell you first, ARISE is a coalition of 150 groups across Alabama. Hi, come on in. And we're church groups, we're nonprofits, we're direct service agencies, we're community groups. Our common interest is finding solutions to the causes and consequences of poverty. And we do that through state policy. So primarily we're looking at things that go on in the legislature in Montgomery. Sometimes we look at federal policies and how they interact with the state and how they're implemented in the state. So healthcare, education, infrastructure, these are our bread and butter. And really a lot of what we talk about are taxes and budgets. And so that's why I'm here today talking about taxes and budgets. So we have a vision statement for our organization and a vision statement for our state. It's on the first page. And then one of our visions for the state is that government leaders are responsive and inclusive. People have the information they need to engage in the policymaking process. When it comes to budgets, there's a lot of information that we don't have. Most of us don't see the budget being made and understand what all is funded in there. Principles of a sound state budget. It's adequate. It covers all of our needs. Number one, it's transparent. You and I know what our state is funding. It's forward thinking, so we're planning ahead for not just this year, but 20 years down the road. What do we want Alabama to look like? What do we need to invest in today? And this is the thing that our Alabama ARISE talks about a lot. Our budget should reflect our values. It's not just a balance sheet, it's a statement of our values. So again, I mentioned ARISE has some values that we think are important for our state. But I know that all of you are here because you value education. And so primarily we're going to be talking about education funding today. Okay, so $29 billion is the total amount of money in our budgets, our education trust fund and our general fund budget. If you look on page 4, you'll see a pie chart that shows how that $29.1 billion is divided up. So between the education trust fund on the right, the education trust fund is about, $14.6 billion. So around half. And then the general fund is of all the non-education expenses, for the most part, and that's $14.4 billion. How do we fund those two budgets, 14.6, 14.8, 14.4? Our state tax dollars is a big portion of it. But the feds bring in a lot of money to our state. Okay, for every $1 you and I pay in federal taxes, our state brings back around $3. So we are receiving a lot of subsidizing from other states' federal tax dollars. That's an important thing to keep in mind. A lot of these federal grants and reimbursements are matching funds for the money that our state provides through state and local taxes. That's an important thing to keep in mind. So if you cut a portion from one side, you're going to cut some of the income from the other side. And so around, 43% of spending in our state is funded by the federal government. We're not going to talk so much about that, although Trisha's might get into that with education. We're going to talk about what our state spends. And if y'all have any questions, by the way, just speak up. And for the new people who came in, there's donuts and coffee. Okay, so that some percent that is our funded by our state taxes, what taxes are we talking about? Most people refer to taxes as a three-legged stool: property tax, income tax, sales tax. Now, a three-legged stool needs to have evenly sized legs. But you'll notice our state property tax is actually a very small portion of our state taxes. Income tax is disproportionately large, and sales tax is also large. This is not including any local taxes. So you may pay more property taxes to your, you know, city, but you also pay more sales taxes to your city or county. This is just the taxes that go to the state. So our state sales tax is 4%. Our state income tax, everyone pays a flat 5% once you meet a very basic threshold, and so on. But you'll notice that, again, the two big pieces of this that are really huge sources of revenue for our state are income tax and sales tax. And okay, so why is that important? Oh, you have a question?
I was going to ask that question. Why is that those big pieces important?
They're important because all of those taxes are earmarked for the Education Trust Fund. So if you go back to page 4 again, it says, actually, let's go to page 6. We moved on to page 6. The Education Trust Fund, this is a pie chart showing what that actually is. It's funding for K-12 schools is the majority, and colleges and universities. Then there's some other things in there. Now, you can see below that there's a pie chart that shows all the general fund expenses. The general fund is a very tiny compared to the Education Trust Fund. I mean, everything we spend on K-12 and universities is like 8 times what we spend on Medicaid, which is the largest expense in the other budget. But so our two biggest sources of revenue are going to fund schools, universities, and colleges. So I think I'm going to flip it over to Trish now.
Thank you. I'm trying to post the link on Facebook. And it's so distracting. Okay, so this is somebody who doesn't multitask very well. All right. Thank you, Rob, for the basic understanding. Question.
Doesn't those taxes being as high as they are disproportionately tax working people?
Yeah, we're going to get to more about taxes.
Can I answer the question?
The question was, don't those taxes disproportionately affect working people? Sales tax and income tax. Yes, they do.
It's kind of building off of that question. I guess you use the phrase, you know, working people, and you know, most everybody obviously works at something. So in terms of maybe a bit more kind of, and I guess my kind of question is, in terms of kind of definitions, in terms of, you know, I guess when you use terms, kind of what exactly do we
right,
mean by
because
them?
Even people who don't work pay sales taxes. So it might be as a euphemism for low-income people or middle-income people. Or, you know, if they're paying the same rate of those taxes as everybody else. Yeah. Yes.
Well, I just want to say, I know I've heard for years and years, we don't pay the property taxes that other states pay. And is there any hope of ever getting the legislature to assess property at a higher rate than they do?
Yes. The question was, is there any hope of paying, you know, more property taxes and being more equitable? We'll talk about that.
We will. We'll get to that. The question was, about property taxes and, you know, what do we
Robyn has a really good slide that shows what we pay versus what other states pay, right? Property taxes are seen as a more stable source of income. Sales taxes are seen as, you know, a tax on the poor, really. It's a consumption tax. And you also have some good slides about which group, you know, pays what level. And I think then we'll get into that further. So I'm going to jump in here and I'm going to talk real quickly about education funding, because of course I'm a little biased. I'm interested in education funding, and that is, I also know more about education funding than I do the general fund, so I was really glad that you're here to explain the general fund too. But this slide is about real and current dollars, and it's something that you learn about in school and then you forget, and sometimes the media forgets to talk to you about real and current dollars. Real dollars are those dollars that have been adjusted for inflation. Am I correct, Dr. Adams? And then it's very important to compare apples and apples. When you have figures from 2008 and 2014, you're fine. Then you can't say $10 in 2008 is worth $10 in 2014. So there are these cool statistical things that you can do to sort of equal all the dollars out. And this presentation will be posted on the Alabama School Connection website. I don't know if Alabama Rise will want to post it there too, but this will all be written up so that you can do these links yourself. Question, if I click that, will it go to a link and come back, or will we lose our presentation?
No, it'll be good.
Will it? Okay. Okay, so current dollars, of course, are exactly that in today's dollars. About a year ago, I got interested in how are we really funding education? You know, everybody says there's not enough money in education, and is that true? How do you know? I mean, that's a really big question, right? We don't have the answers today. How do we know if we've got enough money in Medicaid? We don't. I mean, all we hear is that people say we don't have enough, right? I mean, PARCA has done, the Public Affairs Research Council of Alabama, has done some beautiful analyses. I call them beautiful, but beautiful analyses showing what we need versus what we have versus what the future need will be and how are we going to fund these things. I very much encourage you to hit PARCA's site. It's parcaalabama.org, right? parcaalabama.org. So I'm going to try this. I'm going to click this link. I like this program because it shows you how much time is lost to. Oh my gosh. Okay, you have anything out there that you don't want people to see?
No, okay. We're good.
All right. So what I did, we're not going to go over this, I just want to show you that it's here. It was a very popular post at the time, and it needs to be updated, but now they've changed. Now they want to charge me to post information on there. It's no longer a free tool to do this cool thing. We'll give it like two more seconds to load if it doesn't. What it basically is a way to look at maybe we, you know, spent $2,000 in 2002 and $6,000 in 2008, but it's really a wash. And what we're really doing, I was about to give up. Okay, so the layout here is a little wonky, so we're going to do the best we can. But you can see how the bars are, you know, this is just straight up nominal dollars that show this is how much we funded. But when you click this cool little thing up there, oh my gosh, it's hidden behind Leonard Foster's post. What you see is that the level of funding, we're really funding in inflation-adjusted dollars, much less than we were funding, not just in 2008, but in 2006. Yeah, I wish I knew how to do it. Anyway, now it looks like we're level funding. Maybe we are, maybe we're not. No. But I really, can you get me back to where we were, back to the presentation? As you can see, this is very casual, right? And I don't have a Mac, so I don't know how to operate them. Is that the blue screen there?
No, we're good.
All right, so there's that tool there that you can find. This link will be available. It's really eye-opening to see how little education funding has changed, okay? So when you, next thing I want to talk to you about is this split.
Yes. How little funding has changed? Would you say that in relationship to inflation? The amount is they sort of same?
Okay. I think I understand the question.
we might want the air conditioner on in a little while, okay, y'all, and then we'll just all yell. But this is streaming live on the internet, too. I just want to let folks know who come in. So all of our comments are captured there.
Your intent was to show us a comparison, real versus, I think the term was...
Nominal versus real.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, and the question is, when you, there's some other charts there about receipts, mm-hmm. and you can see our receipts really haven't changed much either. You know, you would think that over time, is that fair to say, Joe? I mean, that's what the numbers themselves, just for the education trust fund, I can't say for the general fund, but looking at receipts, when you normalize them for inflation, mm-hmm. receipts haven't changed much either, okay? So it stands to reason that inflation-adjusted receipts, if they haven't changed much, then expenditures probably haven't changed much either. So we really haven't, we've just been kind of sitting still, treading water. Does that make sense? And again, the general fund is a different beast, and I have not done those numbers to see where that stands. That is sort of why we're all here today, because we know that this looming general fund thing is coming. All right, so very quickly, I want to run through a couple of slides. Is this, don't memorize the numbers. We're live on the internet. I want everybody to know that when they walk in the door. At least I think we are. I haven't checked it in a few minutes. But the blue, you know, you see the blue, this is the level of funding for K-12. The red piece is the funding for higher ed. The green piece is what we call other stuff, okay? And as you can see, in some years, that other stuff gets a lot of money, and that other stuff is not, it's not that it's not important stuff. I mean, the sickle cell foundation gets money through there. These are important functions, things that need to be funded. At least, you know, that's what we assume, right? But the question is, should they be in the education budget? Because we have these two budgets, right? General fund and education budget. So then quickly on the next one, use the arrow instead. That's the split, okay? That those are all, don't look at those numbers too carefully, your eyes will start bleeding. But if you can see, in some years, you know, you've got our other going up to 8%, 10%. Now, I will say this 10% did include some payments back to the rainy day fund, okay? So it doesn't fit in K-12 and it doesn't fit in higher education. So that could be inflated a little bit artificially when we were trying to pay back for some money that we hadn't borrowed. And this is those numbers represented graphically. So Joe, if you were gonna plot a line through there, and I have to reveal, Joe is the, tell me your?
Research
coordinator for PARCA. So that's why I keep looking to Joe.
I don't keep all the data in my head,
though. Oh, yes, you do. Don't pretend that you don't, okay. So as you can see, there's really, you know, on the left side here, is that the y-axis, Joe? The vertical axis
is
Y, the y-axis, is other expenditures, all right? So that's how much we're spending out of the education budget on other stuff, and we'll read you some of that other stuff. But then the total appropriations on the x-axis, the horizontal axis, shows how much was totally appropriated out of the total appropriations for the education trust fund. You can see there's really no pattern. And the only pattern there is that in some years, fiscal year 14, fiscal year 7, fiscal year 6, fiscal year 12, and there's, you know, what do you tie that to? That we decided that there was some reason to spend more money out of the education fund. And I believe that's probably tied to general fund income, revenue being down that year. And so they try to shift a little here and they shift a little there, and it doesn't really make sense. Trey, did you have a question?
Yes, and it's sort of a basic question, but possibly one I shouldn't ask. Why do we have two separate kind of budgets in the state anyway? I mean, like for me, I mean, this is not the best example, but like for me as an individual, I have like the budget for me for all the stuff that I, you know, have to spend money on in a month or whatever, that from what I understand at least, having two separate budgets is not necessarily something that, I can't remember what percentage of the states have like an education budget and a kind of general fund budget, but.
I think there are four.
So like, why do we have the two separate ones?
Well, gosh, let me see. The question is, why do we have two separate budgets? And the first answer is because we always had two separate budgets for a while, okay? A lot of that was due to the strength of Dr. Hubbard in the Alabama Education Association. He was able to, he wanted to protect education dollars. Alabama does not have a strong history of funding education adequately. I think that's a fact as opposed to an opinion. Is that
definitely
fair?
Definitely a fact, yeah.
Okay.
A fact.
Because I'm trying to stay away from opinion here. Okay, so the facts show that we are usually near the bottom.
Wayne Flint, in his book, read the chapter on education.
Okay.
To get a good history.
The comment was to make sure that we all read Wayne Flint's chapter on education funding.
And you mean in Alabama in the 21st century?
Yes.
Okay, Alabama in the 21st century. I didn't know the title of it. And, you know, I think there was a strong push to make sure that education dollars were not appropriated for other things.
Basically, it appears to be, you know, someone who migrated here from up north, it appears to be a valid reason for earmarking. If one values the importance of education.
Okay, and your comment was for those, I hope I'm speaking loud enough for the reporter. The comment was to say that it's a way, if you earmark something, that it's a way of showing it's a priority. And the gentleman who spoke did migrate here, welcome, you've been here for a while, from up north, I won't reveal where. But has brought a wealth of experience. It really helps to hear from outsiders. You know, you're not an outsider. I'm being really euphemistic about that. But we tend to talk about those who don't live in Alabama or haven't been here their whole lives as outsiders. Thank heavens, thanks, Mom. My mother is, she's also in the picture. And you're the only person in the picture. But she's from Alabama, too. So anyway, I digress. All right, so we're gonna go on. I have a list of things. You know, we've got things like the Alabama Law Institute, the Civil Air Patrol, the Department of Human Resources gets a chunk of money from, the Legislative Fiscal Office, the State Council on the Arts, okay? So a lot of people get money from the Education Trust Fund that might not be directly related to schools, but they do get money from there because they couldn't get money from the general fund is what I'm thinking. Is that a fair assumption?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Like, all of the legislature is funded through the Education Trust Fund. Because there's just not money. There's no extra money in the general fund, period. You know, yeah.
Primarily the different county organizations. I'm involved with the ARC of Shelby County. A significant portion of our state assistance comes from the education budget.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that. So what the gentleman was saying, and is it fair to say you're the president of the board of the ARC of Shelby County, and they get a large part of their funding, a lot of the ARCs do in the different counties, they get a large part of their funding from the education budget. So, the fact is that all of these things are in the education budget. There is talk about...
Where they is always raising concerns about taking this money away from the K-12 schools. And while I'm in Hoover, and we do have, we're better off than some of the other rural counties, Larry Lee keeps pointing out that many of these counties are really hurting financially.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they struggle to maintain their school buses.
Right.
And so when those funds are taken out of the ETF, that just puts more strain on these very low-income counties.
That's a very good point, and I'm going to hit that after a few minutes more. I'm getting ready to switch it back to Robyn to get us back on the bigger picture. But these are all links. For those of you who are on the internet, for those of you who are not, I'll print it out and send it to you, Mom. But the locals, one of the articles that I just wrote recently was how the locals are paying more into the foundation program. All right, if you don't know what the foundation program, and you don't know is, and you don't know why the locals are even paying into it, think of it this way. The state funds the schools through the foundation program. That's the primary mechanism. It was a formula-derived thing back in 1995. It was done to promote equity. And what happens every year is the formula is adjusted based on how much money is available in the legislature. And the CFO for the, well, the assistant deputy superintendent, Andy Craig, said at a meeting, a state board meeting, maybe back in January or February, he said, you know, if we stuck with the formula, the funding would be okay. But they readjust the formula every year to fit the amount of money. And that's not really how the foundation program is supposed to work, okay? So that is, and what happens, the locals paying into the foundation program. Let's say the state legislature says, we're gonna give you $1,000, Hoover City Schools, for all your kids. It's more than that, but I'm trying to keep the numbers simple. Then they're gonna count on, they're not gonna give Hoover City Schools that full $1,000, okay? Because to participate in the foundation program, which means to get all that other money that the state's gonna send you, each school district has to pay in the equivalent of 10 mils of property tax. And that's different for everywhere. It's not one rate across the state. Like 1 mil in Baldwin County is worth what, like $3.5 million or something? It's a lot. And so they fund $35 million of the state's, you know, obligation to them. And what's happened over the years is this portion that the locals are funding grows larger and larger. The state really doesn't seem to be paying more and more. Because even if the state reduces what they're paying, let's say they gave the schools $100 for classroom supplies 1 year, but they don't give it to you the next, the locals still have to pay that 10 mils into the program, okay? So that obligation never changes, while what the state allocates and pays out does change, okay? See some funny looks. All right, that's how it is. That's how it works right now. And then how much state, local, and federal money is being spent on our school children, I encourage you to click that link. It's pretty eye-opening. We think we're spending a whole lot of money. Maybe we are, maybe we aren't. Parents paying fees. I did a story a few weeks ago about this, about how much it's like $38 million out-of-pocket fees, paying for classes, parking, lockers, advanced placement classes, advanced placement tests. So there is no such thing as a free public education unless you're looking for the bare minimum offerings, okay? If you want anything other than something bare minimum, you're gonna have to pay for it. And it's been a shifting as the state of Alabama has been able to allocate less, or has chosen to allocate less, whatever the reasons are, they're allocating less than they were to schools. The costs really haven't changed, so it appears that the schools are shifting the cost to the users, to the parents, to the consumers. Those are user fees, okay? And I didn't know we had user fees in education. Anyway, the foundation program is underfunded. What that means is that if the foundation program, remember I told you how the formula changes, how they change the formula every year instead of keeping the formula and allocating the money to fit the formula? Right now, state officials say that the foundation program, if it were fully funded, that we would have $300 million more in our school systems. That's a lot of money, especially when you think the general fund is just looking for $200 million, okay? But what's happened is schools have said, you know, we have to do with what we have. So we're just gonna either shift the cost to parents, or we're gonna drop programs, or we're gonna drop teachers or something else. They have made do with less, which, you know, is an admirable quality. Is that what we want for our kids in education? I don't know the answer to that.
Of course, if you drop teachers, it's larger class sizes, that's what you mean.
And we're gonna talk about that. I've got a few slides on what I'm calling stressors in education funding. Right now, because I've taken so much time, I'm shifting it back to Robyn, and she's gonna talk to us a little more. There's one slide and then I'm back up. So let me just punch up. So you say what you want about this.
Okay, well, just to summarize what we've discussed, there are two big chunks of revenue for the state, sales tax and income tax, are earmarked for education. To go back to the question, why do we have an education trust fund? Our state, you know, values education. And we earmark, it's a lot easier for us to raise revenue if we earmark it for a specific purpose. And if you read the comments on AL.com, which I do not encourage, you'll find the most, even the most anti-tax person will say, I only want to spend money on education. Okay, that's kind of, if you want to look at what our state says we value, education will be that. So this is how that $5.8 billion is funded. The state, that's the state, you know, portion of our education.
Do you want, there's some notes here, do you want to go there?
I mean, a few things to note, like, compared to the general fund, this is a lot more stable source of funding. And like Trish said, when it comes time to find funding for things that don't fit in the other fund, that don't have earmarked funding available, they'll call it an education expense. So the funding for the ARC is for education for disabled adults, from what I understand. So that's basically, you know, the only thing I wanted to mention. And, you know, Trish has made the point with several slides that funding has not increased to meet the needs year after year.
The use tax, which is 4%, that's the piece that some proposals are looking to move from the education trust fund over to the general fund.
Yes, that use tax, that sales tax you pay on out-of-state purchases. So if you buy a car from out-of-state, or theoretically, if you buy something online and you're not taxed at the point of sale, you can pay use taxes on that too. And
I thought it was kind of a fun thing to go back and forth, right? Y'all won't get bored with either one of us, right? Robyn is much more interesting to listen to. The Rolling Reserve Act. We've heard a lot about the Rolling Reserve Act, okay? It was passed in 2011. It was done to make sure that we don't have these big hits where we don't have enough money in the education trust fund and we've already budgeted it out, and then school districts are hit with what's called proration, which might come in the middle of a school year where you've already contracted teachers. You cannot cut back on what you pay teachers, okay? You cannot prorate salaries. But if you find, the last recession hit us, it didn't hit us where we could predict and budget for it on October 1st of 2008, you know. It just sort of evolved, and we saw where receipts were not matching up with what we had budgeted, and so they declared proration, and they said, all right, 6%, we're gonna pay out to the school district 6% less each month for the remainder of the year than we had planned. Well, it isn't like the school districts can just cut their expenditures by 6%. Now, some of them were able to do some pretty creative things. You know, they were able to work on some energy saving initiatives and that kind of thing. But they didn't really, it impacts their ability to plan. And what they end up doing is using their local money, their local tax money, which some districts have very little local tax money, to fill in that hole, especially for salaries, okay? So what it does, it said, and it sounded really good. It said, all right, we're gonna use an average of the last 15 years, you know, evening out all the bumps, right? Maybe your income went up by 7% one year and then went back down to 2%, and then it went down, you know, to 3% less, 4% less, 5% less, and it shot up 8%. The idea was to even out all those bumps. And it made sense at the time the arguments were being made. There were a lot of folks that saw a little farther down the road and said this might not be a good idea, especially with these 4 years of negative, negative receipts. So it was, and the reason for it, not only to smooth proration, but it was also to pay back the money that we borrowed out of a savings account called a rainy day fund. It was going to pay back that savings account so that we'd have it there in case we had another lousy few years of receipts, okay? So theoretically, we borrowed from ourselves and we have to pay it back, right? Well, as of September 30th of this year, it is expected to be fully paid back. Okay, and I think the number was like $437 million. Is that right, Joe? Does that sound okay? Somewhere around there. It's a lot of money, all right? And we successfully put off probation for like 9 months by paying, you know, by borrowing the money back in 08 and 09, okay? So the Rolling Reserve Act is still in place, all right? So now we've limited the amount that we're gonna send out to the schools, right? By that, whatever that percentage is over 15 years. And then, and we're gonna go to this slide. So theoretically, we have this much extra money every year, extra. It's really important that we understand what extra does or does not mean. And so we had in fiscal year 13, the rolling reserve cap was an amount, it's a really complicated calculation, we're not gonna keep your heads in with that, okay? Because it has to do with growth revenues, recurring revenues, non-recurring revenues, and percentages, and all this stuff. And there are some slides, and I will get those up on our site eventually. There's some articles that I have written about it right now. But so we paid back about $260 million, I think it was, this first year. We were able to say, you know, fiscal year 13, we rebounded. And basically what we're saying is we withheld that money from being distributed through the Education Trust Fund, okay? So that's $260 million that could have been allocated, but we had to pay ourselves back. That makes sense, right? Another $70 million in fiscal year 14, and a fiscal year runs from October 1 to September 30th. And so fiscal year 13, FY fiscal year 13, means the year beginning October 1, 2012 to September 30th, 2013, okay? The number denotes the ending year, all right? Now that's not the school year. You'll notice the school year runs from August to whenever, May or June or whenever it does. And so then in fiscal year 15, we were able to pay back, and some of these are estimates. I mean, I'm pulling them from lots of different sources. There isn't like just a nice guidebook for all this stuff. There are a bunch of books with a bunch of different information. Trying to pull it together in one place is our goal, isn't it, Joe? It's our goal. In fiscal year 16, now this was a projection back in June. I don't think this is really gonna hold true. It looks like there's gonna be like, you know, 160 to 200 million extra in the Education Trust Fund, extra, right? So, gosh, we need 200 million for the general fund. It looks like a perfect match, doesn't it? So this is where, you know, you have to hand it to our legislators. They're looking for money, right? And if you just see a big old pot of money over there, it has to open your eyes. I mean, if you get a $1,000 bonus check from work, and you really need to put that in your savings account, but you really need to fix your car for $1,000, you might go ahead and fix your car for $1,000, right? And not put it, not invest it, not save it. Anyway, so those are some numbers. So here are these slides about stressors on education funding. There have been a number of things that have put a lot of stress on education funding. Fiscal year 08 was sort of the watershed year where everybody said, oh, we're doing well. At least that's what we say now, looking back, okay? Were we? I don't even know. But now, if you look at it now, it looks like we had a lot of money in schools, right? But even then, there were still needs that were not being met, I'm sure. So in fiscal year 12, the legislature raised what are called the divisors. Okay, divisors are not the same as pupil-teacher ratio. All right, divisors are part of that foundation formula. All right, so it might say Avondale Elementary, you have 122 first graders. The divisor is 14.25, and we're going to allocate you whatever that number was, divided by 14.25 is. That's how many first grade units, which is, you can think of as a teacher, you're gonna get in funding. Well, in an effort to, fill some gaps back in fiscal year 12, they changed the divisors. They raised them just a little bit. But that one little bit resulted in 2,100 classroom teachers, 2,100 fewer classroom teachers, and 1,700 fewer support personnel across the then 132 districts, 133, maybe 134, I can't remember. So that's a lot of people, you know? If you go back, there are organizations that will go back and quote you how many teachers we've lost since fiscal year 08. It's a lot. But yet enrollment has stayed the same, basically. We've had, you know, little bitty fluctuations of 1,000 students across the state here and there. But when you spread those 1,000 students across, you know, and you think they're all in different grades, it's not the same as saying 2,100 classroom teachers. I think we have, 40, I wrote the number down, I forgot to break it with me, 45,000 classroom teachers right now? Okay. So that's good. All right? And then you look at the average per pupil expenditure. I'm using that fiscal year 08 as a watershed year. This is the statewide average. We school districts pay out about $9,100 per student. That's how much they spent. And that does not include capital projects, okay? Building new schools, that kind of thing. The city systems, which always, they always pay more, you know, always have more money than the counties do. City systems, 9,600, county systems, 8,800. You can see the numbers for fiscal year 14. And those are current dollars. Those are not adjusted for inflation, okay? So if you adjust them for inflation, we would expect to see an even wider range there. So school districts are making do with less, because these are per pupil expenditures. More stressors. In fiscal year 07, right before the crash, we added 5 days to the school year. You know, we forget about these things that we did to why we paid more and why the expenditures went up. It added $94 million to the bottom line to add those 5 school days. Now districts are able to use the equivalent of 180 days. And I'm sure there were some budget thoughts in there, you know, that maybe you add 5 minutes to the school day so that you get the equivalent of the hours. I've got feelings about that, but the research shows that that is not an effective method. You know, if you're gonna add 5 minutes to each period, that really doesn't, you know, it may reduce the number of days you go to school, it may make your school day longer, but it doesn't necessarily result in more learning for children, all right? And the districts are applying this differently. And also, if you think about technology, where we were in fiscal year 07 and 08, we're talking 7-8 years ago, where we are now, right? And what's happened is local districts are trying to give opportunities for technology, and they want an iPad in children's hands, or they want, because we know that's where it's going, they're paying for that themselves. Or they're finding grants, or they're shifting money from something else. They're not building schools. You know, they're finding ways to get that technology. Some of them, not all of them. There are school districts where they don't have wireless infrastructure. They don't have internet in schools. And you think about in rural areas, you know, how are those kids, are those kids going to be able to migrate to a bigger city to get a better job? No experience with technology. This is where you start talking about the haves and the have-nots. Okay. Teacher raises, right? I'm not here to advocate for teacher raises. What I'm going to tell you is they haven't had a meaningful raise since fiscal year 07 or 08. Might have been 08. And they had a 2% raise in fiscal year 14, but they had also had some cost shifting a few years earlier, where they paid more of their own retirement costs, they paid more of their own health insurance costs, and a lot of people call this a wash. I have not done the numbers on it, so I can't say for sure it's a wash, but I know that there has been no teacher raise, meaningful teacher raise, since I'm pretty sure it's fiscal year 07. If I'm wrong, I certainly will correct it. There are talks of teacher shortages because people aren't wanting to go into teaching. My daughter is going into teaching, which I probably should have broadcast that. We'll change her last name, is what we'll do. But she's going to go into teaching. Can she make a meaningful living? I can tell you, her first 2 years, if she's getting first and second year salary, she will live it all with me. She will not be able to afford her own apartment and live somewhere else. And then teacher preparation programs, the universities and the colleges that are preparing teachers to educate, to go out into the classrooms, they're being asked to do a lot more. We are raising the bar here in Alabama. We're not getting a lot of news coverage about it. There's some really big initiatives going on there at the state to say that the teacher prep programs, University of Alabama, how did this teacher do when this teacher went out into the field?
all right? This teacher is an effective teacher, and I'm not even going into measures of effective teachers, okay? So the last slide I have to talk about now is there a surplus in an education trust fund, all right? This is what we're hearing over and over again. I'm sorry. Anyway, there is not a surplus in the education trust fund. There is money that is not being allocated because of the rolling reserve cap. That does not make it a surplus. You think of a surplus when all the needs are met and you don't have anywhere else to spend that money, right? There is not a surplus, okay? Schools are making do with less, and all of the school districts are struggling. I don't know a single school district, and I went to, and I won't call them out here, but I attended a budget hearing for the wealthiest district in the state, okay? I heard them, it was just the board members, the superintendent, and me. These things are fun to go to, y'all. You really need to attend your school district budget hearings. You're not with me, right? Even this superintendent said, we are concerned about our reserve balance, how much money we have in the reserves to spend on operating expenditures. They're at their lowest level since like 2003. They're funding more and more of what they consider a basic education out of local money, things that the state used to fund. So, and it was said this way, I thought this was really well said. The superintendent talked about the good old days of proration. Now that's a little bit frightening when you hear somebody start talking about the good old days of proration. Because what that meant was, he was talking about this in relation to the rolling reserve. He did not use the term good old, okay? That is my addition. He just said, in the days of proration, you knew what to expect. You might have a bad year, but you'll come back. You know that somewhere down the line, you can start building up the reserve again. But the way it is now, with allocations and appropriations just being held down, you're not getting the opportunity to redistribute that money and rebuild. So that was eye-opening. I have not written that article yet. I will eventually. But it was eye-opening to hear that school district talk about worrying about money. And I think some of the residents who are watching right now, they're probably a little surprised too. So I'm going to turn it back over to Robyn, and you're going to finish out, and I'll have some closing remarks. Does anybody have any questions about what I just said?
I was just going to comment. Many of you are familiar with the Hoover school bus problem. And if the buses had been fully funded, then that would not have come up. If the state was only paying 75% of the cost of the bus, and the local district was having to make that up, and Mr. Craig was claiming that Hoover could not afford that makeup, and so we needed to cut the buses.
Right, and what the comment was for the folks on the internet, it was about the struggle that Hoover had funding buses back in 2013. And the claim was that, and it was true, that the state is not fully funding transportation. And I think it's a perfect example of when you get down to the very basic of just getting back and forth from school, and you don't have a ride to and from school, you can't get educated, right? And the state is not fully funding transportation, and hasn't in years. They pay, I think this year went up to about $6,300 per bus over a 10-year period, basically, which says the thinking there is that $6,300 times 10 years will give you $63,000 to purchase a new bus. Buses cost a lot more than $63,000. So I appreciate that comment. Yeah, I think transportation is the one that is so easy to point at and say, we can't even fund transportation. You know, I mean, school buses are just, you know, we're used to these short routes on school buses. There are kids in rural areas that ride the bus 2.5 to 3 hours a day. There are kids in the district I live in that ride the bus an hour and a half a day because they live in remote parts of my district. So I don't know how, you know, that's a long school day for kids. When you start at 6:15 and you get home at 5:30 or 4:30, that's a really difficult day for kids. And that is because we're trying to be efficient, fill up the bus as much as we can, travel as far as we can out and come back. Yes?
Could you have her talk that the school systems are looking into all this distance learning and technology learning and so forth? How will that affect transportation costs, rural children? How is technology the magic answer for this, or part of the answer?
Okay, so the question was, could technology be seen in distance learning as part of the answer for giving more kids access to more opportunities in education?
Yes.
I mean, Alabama was the first to create the Access Program, and Access is all in capital letters. I can't remember what it stands for, but if you were...
Is Alabama connecting classrooms something...
Education.
Very good.
Alabama connecting classrooms.
My former employer did a write-up on it.
Okay.
So that's the only one. I feel like I should know all the like acronyms, but
that's good. Letters,
but I guess half.
That's good. That's more than I did.
A lot of places do not have high speed internet.
Well, and this was the next point. Okay, last year, the year before, and maybe the year before that, there was an act introduced into the legislature, not an act, a bill. An act, according to the glossary, is one that has become a law. It's a great glossary. It's called the Alabama Ahead Act. And every year it sort of morphs into something different, but it's based around like $1 billion worth of bonds, or $100 billion worth of bonds, or it's a lot of money, okay? And every year they change and it never passes. It never makes it through the legislature. Because it would be issuing bonds, issuing new debt, but they keep changing the thing they want to pay for it. And the technology people who work in schools, their organization, really wanted to see the latest incarnation bill pass, which had to do with building up wireless infrastructure in schools. It wasn't for hardware, it wasn't for software, it wasn't for iPads, it wasn't for programs. It was just to give every school access to the internet. And I think that part of it was like $50 million. And it was called WIRED, W-I-R-E-D. It was this long-term plan to get internet into every classroom. And I do believe that you can hear people talk about, well, if you don't have to take kids to school and they can sit in their house and learn, then that's great, right? But then I would just challenge you to think about the other social functions of school when they work well. That there are other purposes for a school other than just to teach education.
And you're also assuming that somebody's going to be sitting here at home with them.
That's a very good point. And the point was made that the assumption is that there will be an adult overseeing that education at home.
But not so much for the K through sixth graders, but for the, and many are they not? So many high schools already have that sixth day or that little time off that you can go home and use your internet.
Yes.
I mean, for the higher skilled children who don't need to work on that independence, they all choose to their independence at school.
And the point is being made about the electronic days where you hear like, especially when we had the snow, so much snow a couple of years ago, instead, there was no way they were going to extend school. I mean, to be honest, it takes money to extend school. Every school day is worth a certain amount of money to the state budget, okay? And I don't know what that figure is. I need a good figure to figure out. But there are a lot of districts will have what they'll call an E-day or an internet day, and it'll be a Saturday where they're expected to complete an assignment online. And typically they're not real in-depth, let's put it that way. There are examples of I can go online and I can do this work and I can turn it in. And there are a lot of, I think the concern is, trying to word this the right way, is that the assignments are rich enough to demonstrate real learning.
Well, I know like in Georgia, they have supporting homeschooling, where the district themselves oversees the children who work in the homeschool environment, and then they are tested and they receive at the school system. So the school system oversees the education of the children without the direct management.
One of the things that I've learned from the issue that I have with this is that all of this, frankly, flies in the face of public education, which is essential. And overlooking things like some people out of education, and they get them accessible to others. And that's.
And you are a former teacher, wasn't you?
Yes, I am a former.
And also serves on the board of our organization.
And I completely agree with you.
So I have a problem with these days, banning that, it's not supportive of public education on the broadness.
Well, and the concerns, I mean, these are really valid concerns to bring up, because there is, you know, this idea, I'm a follower of the David Matthews idea about public education, which is the public owns the public schools. Public schools serve a purpose far beyond educating students, that they're hubs of activity, and that they allow people to connect, and that they if they're diverse, they can broaden empathy, they can broaden understanding, they can, you know, they're central to society, not just an add-on. So I subscribe to that, but I also know that when you're working with your own child and the public school in your that you're zoned to isn't working for your child, it's really difficult to hang in there. And so I think this is what we're hearing, sort of like the individual need to educate individual children versus the holistic purpose of public schools. And I see this as an ongoing conversation that there's really not a great answer to. And I think there are some who fear that this investment in technology is breaking down the public school system so that one day there won't be a school building. You know, far off in the future, there are no school buildings. Maybe they'll come to places like this, and everybody will hook into the internet, and maybe groups of children will learn together. But that's assuming that you have access to a building that has wireless infrastructure and internet, and you have your own devices and all of these
libraries.
Like the public libraries that are also struggling with that.
If I can add on personally, when you talk about technology and using it for learning and whatnot, there is very often an assumption that technology is a neutral tool. I mean, it's like being back, when I was in college and whatnot, you talk about the information superhighway, this idea of, you can find all this stuff on the internet that you couldn't necessarily find in like your actual public library, but when you kind of look more deeply at that, you find that actually even the stuff that you find on the internet is really just more of the same stuff. But so I guess my sense of things from the information that I've seen is that, yes, technology can be useful, but it's something that we should be cautious before we jump too far on the bandwagon.
I appreciate that,
but actually, the internet is really our interstate highway system. The numbers from single digit to 99, then it's the three-digit interstate to spread out, and then the state and county and local roads. And without that infrastructure, you can't get information unless, like Google is playing with, putting balloons up in the air to provide wireless.
I wouldn't wear that. I appreciate that comment, Arnold, and you're right. But it is, we have to be really careful, because it's easy to assume that most of us have an iPad in our purses or in our, briefcases, or we have multiple tools, we have smartphones. There are a lot of people that don't have access to the internet. And in something as simple as what's happened with our local media, we don't have daily newspapers in Birmingham anymore. So if you don't have access to the internet, and you're not finding some daily publication to talk to you, and your preferred method of learning, you learn best through reading, you're really disenfranchised. And that is the potential. That is what's happening. You know, when I'm about to produce and publish an article to show that the district, the spread of local money, because that's really what people are using, what school districts are using to buy technology with, is local money. local money, and that's, you know, the tax money that you put in the pool to educate all the children in your, whatever your area is, county or city, is $600 a student, okay? $600 a student, that's for a year, that you get $600 for a student. The highest amount is $6,700 a student. So we've got, we are setting ourselves up, we already have in place an elite group of children that are getting an elite education in the public school system. And then farther down, you've got about 500,000 children, which we only have 740,000 in the state, 500,000 children that whose districts don't have the money to buy extra things for them to learn, to go on cool field trips or to go. So we have, it's already there, it's already stratified. It's been growing, the range has been growing over the years. And then when you think about that local money, you have to use that local money to fill in the holes that the state might not be funding. I'm not sure where we're going. I don't have any opinions on it. I know what the facts show, and I think about if I were the parent of a child in a district that was getting $600 or that had $600 in local money to use to buy extra things, enrichment is what we're talking about here. And then you're up against, that child is going to be up in for the same jobs, not really, but theoretically, right? The same jobs that the kids who are getting $6,700 per student in local money to spend. I'm not sure they both have equal opportunity. And this is public education, and that's what we have to decide. You know, is this parental pursuit or public education? Are we looking for individual pursuit, and therefore the stratification of local money is fine with us? Or are we saying, you know, there needs to be more equity in funding? And so I have proselytized. No, I'm trying to be factual here, and I think I've really... I withhold opinions. All I know is what the facts show. And the facts are not reassuring that we're going to have that children in these districts, in the county districts, in the rural districts, that don't have a lot of money available to buy even special education aids. Nobody funds special education aids. You know, the locals have to do that. So even something as simple as that, that you just sort of take for granted that if your child needs an aid in class, that they're going to have that, it's not there unless the locals have money for it. So you can see where kids are not getting equal access to equal education based on what the numbers show.
Now, Hoover set up a virtual high school. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm sure everyone who participates in virtual high school, they'll have high-speed internet in their home. Now, the school district is not paying for that internet connection.
That's right. It's not at the taxpayer's cost. That's a very good point, Dan. What Dan just pointed out is that when we do online education, most of us are paying our own internet bills, right? So, like my son, who is an online gamer, said, Mom, I'll fill in the extra if we can get that 45 megabytes a second. That 24 just isn't cutting it anymore. So, for the higher cost, which... did I let him fund it? Just $9 more a month. You know, we're learning a little bit about trying to pay your own expenses, right? In his college housing, he just volunteered to pay for the higher internet speed, but he has the money. See, most kids, most 20-year-olds aren't gonna have $20 a month to fork out just for an internet service, a high-speed internet service.
And dial-up is not gonna do it.
Dial-up is not going to do it. Right. Okay. I'm going to sit down here, take a breath. We are an hour into our meeting, and I don't know if you want to take a few minutes break and come back.
Yeah.
I'm going
to
let you
call. I think it'd be good to take a break now.
Okay.
And just to let everyone know again, the restrooms are right there. There's coffee, there's water, donuts, and let me know if you need it.
Thank you.
So... basically, we've spent so much time hammering home what is in the Education Trust Fund budget, because one of the things that's happening right now is legislators are talking about moving money from education to cover needs in the general fund. And Trish did a great job explaining how the rolling reserve prevents all the money coming into the Education Trust Fund from being spent every year. 2008 was when the recession hit, and we still haven't recovered our funding for education to pre-recession levels. So I just wanted to go back and remind you, this is what we spend on education. Pretty straightforward. K-12 to your colleges, universities. And how we fund it. Growth taxes, income tax and sales tax. Why are they called growth taxes? Because when the economy rebounds, these tax revenues increase. So more people are employed, that's more income taxes. More people are buying goods at Walmart, that's sales tax revenue. When the economy is doing poorly, of course, those revenues suffer, which is why we had proration, which is why the legislature has limited the growth of education spending every year to put some of that money in reserve. Okay, that's just a summary. We're going to talk about the general fund budget. And then we're going to get into taxes. Okay, general fund budget is much smaller than the education trust fund. Remember when we first opened and we said they're about equal when you bring in all the federal funding and local funding, they're about the same size. But when you look at just state funding, most of our state funding is going to education. And a lot of that is earmarked. But we have huge other needs that state taxes fund. Things like our Medicaid program, which is a healthcare program for low-income people. Very small program in the sense that it's not easy to enroll in Medicaid. Most of the people on it are low-income women, moms, expectant mothers. So not even just women, they actually are expectant mothers. Children are covered under children's health insurance, which is Medicaid. Alabama was one of the first states to cover all of our children through Medicaid, which is something we should be very proud of as a state. But it's also a big expense in the general fund, and it doesn't have an earmarked source of funding.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
At what time did Alabama become the first state to cover all our kids? How long ago was that?
That was in the 2000s, recently, yeah. Prisons. You know, would you rather build a school or would you rather build prisons? Most people don't want to think about funding prisons, but our prison population has skyrocketed in the past 25 years. This is a national phenomenon, but the funding for prisons has not increased, right? So our prisons are at around 200% capacity, which means we're at risk of being sued by the federal government or having a federal takeover, because that is unconstitutional to treat prisoners in substandard conditions. Like, you know, most prisons don't have air conditioning. Just one thing to think about when we have hot summers. Mental health. DHR, so ADMH, that's mental health. We've seen mental hospitals closing in North Alabama. That means when your friend or neighbor or loved one is admitted to the hospital, they need a bed for psychiatric services. That bed is not there. They're having to find beds in other places. Department of Human Resources, that's DHR. This is child protection services, child welfare. Public health, public safety, the court system. So these are huge functions of the state. And this is how we fund them, with a hodgepodge of, I'm sorry about the image quality here, a hodgepodge of fees and taxes and one-time windfall money that comes in, like when we get a settlement, say for BP or, that, I don't think BP money is going there, but you get the idea. So, unlike the Education Trust Fund, they're really scrambling to put together and piece together the pieces of the general fund. Okay, we've talked a lot about earmarks. I hope everybody knows what an earmark is. That's when you raise a tax, you go to vote on the tax, and it says this money will be used for X. It's great when people are anti-tax to show them, oh, this is why this is important to me. I value this. But we don't have earmarks for all those other needs in the general fund. We do have some earmarks like often earmarks are linked, like, in some way to the items they're funding. So agricultural fees obviously would fund the Department of Agriculture. Environmental management fees, you know, are supposed to go to fund the Department of Environmental Management. Cigarette taxes go to DHR, mental health, public health. Whiskey taxes go to human resources. I find this one really kind of sad, but marriage license fees are going to domestic violence shelters. And actually, the domestic violence advocates had to work for many years just to secure that source of funding. Okay. Oh, so we're getting into taxes. Most of this book is about taxes, how they work, what they look like. We define tax fairness as a progressive tax system. If you look on page 14 of the book, you'll find a progressive tax system is one at which those with more ability to pay a higher percentage. Those with less ability to pay a lower percentage, all right? So it increases, as your wealth increases, your taxation increases. Alabama has a regressive system, which means people with less ability to pay are paying a higher percentage in state and local taxes.
And the sales tax on food too also.
Right. So what do we want in this tax system? We want it to be adequate, like a budget system needs to meet the needs of the budget. Simple, transparent, you can understand when you pay taxes, where they're going, and fair. And again, fairness we define as being progressive. Now, there are ideological differences, and people have different ideas about this, but the fact of the matter is we're not even approaching a flat tax system. We're so regressive in this state. And this is what it looks like. So this is the bottom 20% of income earners, second 20%, middle 20%, fourth 20%. And then we've broken down the top 20% into, you can see the top 1%, the top, you know, the rest of the top 5%. And as when you combine all of the income taxes, property taxes, sales taxes that people pay in these brackets, the lowest income people are paying the highest percentage. And the majority, the big cost for that is because of sales taxes, which is the green bar. Okay, and you'll see that on page 26. Yeah.
Sorry, going back to the previous graph, I noticed that as you get kind of higher up in the income distribution, that kind of reddish piece of the bar is kind of higher, is kind of higher up, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Is that meaning that the more kind of income you have, the more you're paying in property taxes, or
no.
What exactly does that mean?
So just compare, we'll break all these out.
Okay.
So you can look at income taxes, we'll look at sales tax, we'll look at property tax, but this is cumulative. So you can see that the red portion is about the same size on every level. That's because property taxes are basically flat. And even if you don't own a home, you still, your landlord pays property taxes, and that might be translated into your rent. So,
question.
Yes.
Well, I was going to say that usually higher income people have more property and they pay higher taxes because their property is valuable. So I can't see that everybody would be saying the same in property taxes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll talk about that. Why does it look like that?
Yeah.
Okay. So when Alabama first started raising income taxes in 1935 was our first income tax. It was one of the most progressive tax systems in the nation. This is a famous photo from Walter Evans of Alabama in 1935, in the middle of the Great Depression. Our state had tremendous needs. We weren't meeting our budget needs. We didn't have enough money. This was the governor at the time, Benjamin Meek Mills, which, if you try to Google his name, it'll try to tell you to go to Meek Mill, the rapper who's having a beef with Drake. No, this is Meek Mills, the governor in 1935. He had to go around the state and convince people to pay income taxes. It was very unpopular at the time, but what he did was say, look, if you're not paying federal income taxes, you're not going to pay state income taxes. When they passed this tax, only people making, I believe, $3,500 a year or more would be taxed at that 5% rate, okay? Now, at that time, that was a lot of money. Very few people made that amount of money. Most teachers made about $500 a year, for reference. So it was progressive, and when he raised that tax, he actually was able to double the amount of roads, paved roads in the state. It made some big improvements. The problem was that there was nothing in that tax that said, we need to raise this with inflation. So as cost of living increases, as the value of money decreases, from 1935 to 2006, we had only raised the threshold at which you start paying it, I believe, to $4,600. So $4,600 in 2006 is a lot less money than $3,500 was in 1935. So, and that was for a household of four people would be taxed at that level. Our state did reform this a little bit. We raised the threshold so that now you start paying income taxes for a family of four at around $12,000. But that's still a very low income. That's still below the poverty line. We're one of very few states who taxes people living in poverty, taxes their income. Okay, so there is a deduction that you're exempted some of that income, but this is the curve. What are income taxes like? It's a 5% tax on your income, but there's a standard deduction and all these other deductions that you can take. And Alabama is the black bar on the left. So low income, bottom 20% of income earners in Alabama pay, probably five times as many income taxes as the average of other states do. And if you look at, let's just say the top 20%, they're all paying significantly less than their counterparts in other states do. Okay? And so, the bottom half, the lower half of earners across the board are paying higher income taxes than the average people do in other states. And this is that deduction that I mentioned. We have a very low standard deduction. So one reform that could be made to make our tax a little bit more progressive would be to raise the deduction level. For example, to make it look more like the federal deduction does. So before I move on, any questions about income taxes? Yes?
I just want to make sure everybody understands that in Alabama, if you are fortunate enough to have a defined pension, you pay no state income taxes.
That's correct.
So all of the teachers, all of the military personnel, all of the civil servants, all of the state government employees who have a pension pay no state income taxes.
None.
Is that
none?
On the pension part.
Yes, on the pension part. For many of us, that's the majority of our income. And it doesn't matter how rich or how poor you are, you will pay zero state income taxes. That is not the case in most states.
And also you don't pay income tax on Social Security.
Right.
Yes.
Can you repeat that?
So when you eliminate all of these people, all of us retirees who have state, federal, military retirees, you know, installations we have in Alabama. I know that they're enjoying all the state services, while those who are having 401k plans are having to pay state income tax. We could be getting billions of dollars. And I wrote my state senator about this last year, and he did not even respond. Because nobody wants to touch retirees from military and state teachers.
Yeah, so what we've been discussing is the fact that retirees' pensions are not taxed, and Social Security is not taxed.
And I have a state of New Jersey retirement, which is also a defined benefit, and that's not taxed.
Okay.
So it's not even income that I receive from Alabama.
Right. Out of state, defined benefits. Yeah. Sales taxes is the number one contributor to our regressive tax system. It's why it looks like this instead of like this. And this is pretty simple because we don't tax services, we tax goods. So everybody needs food, over-the-counter medicine, uniforms for your kids to go to school. Doesn't matter how much money you make, go to the thrift store, you're going to pay a sales tax on that. One interesting thing to note about sales taxes is, let's say I'm thrifty, I want to cut my kids' hair. I go buy scissors, I pay taxes on those scissors. I'm wealthy. I go take my daughter to the salon and get her $80 worth of, you know, haircut and highlights. I don't pay taxes on that transaction. Sales taxes are more of a burden on low-income people for that very reason. Okay, most states exempt groceries, that's food that you purchase to prepare, from being taxed. Several states have tax breaks for clothes and medicine and stuff like that. Alabama is one of only four that does not.
Well, around here, a lot of the sales tax is 10%. That's the highest. I think that is maybe 11% some places. But generally, this is considered the highest level in the nation. And we're taxing food, vegetables, and groceries.
Yes.
And so it's a double whammy.
Yeah, those sales taxes, the highest one in the state is 10.5%. That's for a city in Lowndes County. Yes.
No. I was trying to say, there was a question about medicine over there. Prescriptions are not taxed.
Right.
But over-the-counter medications are taxed, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, you're good. I'm going to move on. So, this is the question about property taxes. It's pretty flat. Again, this is the percentage of their income, family income, that is being spent on these taxes. So you may be in the top 5%, top 1%, and you own a lot more property than us down here in the bottom 40, but you're paying the same rate, okay? One thing I want to mention about sales tax, too. So the state sales tax is 4%, but here in Jefferson County, you pay 10%. Why is that? Well, because our city and our county levy sales taxes as an easy way to make up those gaps in funding for schools, for roads. You'll see a lot of, you know, budget agenda items where they say, we really need to build a new road in Madison County. Let's do a 1% sales, 1 cent sales tax. You know, we really need new schools in Mobile. Let's do a special agenda item. And sales tax is where they go to get that. So that's also contributing to, you know, our state is not funding these things, so our cities and our counties have to fund them. Property taxes. Now, Alabama has some of the lowest in the nation. As a share of all of our tax revenue, it's the lowest. So that hampers our budget. You know, if I mentioned the three-legged stool, property, income, sales, if one leg is so short, we're missing out on some revenue there. And our neighboring states, charge more property taxes than we do. Or they bring in more revenue than we do. Okay, now here's business taxes. We want to be a business-friendly state. This is something we hear a lot from our representatives. And so, you know, we still charge businesses the same taxes that individuals pay. Property taxes, sales taxes, they have to pay some licenses and fees. Corporate income tax, I wanted to know that. That is a very, very small portion of this pie. So if you look at what I individual pay in income taxes as a percentage of taxes I pay versus what a corporation pays, they're paying a lot lower income taxes. Now, another thing, a lot of federal legislation lowers the tax burdens on corporations, and that, as a result, has lowered our state tax revenue from those corporations, because they're pretty much tied to each other. So since 2005, our corporate income tax has declined 11%. A good thing I want to note here is that some corporations you'll hear about getting huge tax incentives to relocate to Alabama. The Mercedes plant was a big one. You'll see we're competing with bidding with our neighboring states. We want you to come here, we'll give you all these tax breaks. We've had no way to track those in our state budget. It's just, we pass this tax incentive, we never see that revenue, we never revisit it 10 years down the road or 20 years down the road. Senator Hightower passed a law this year mandating that every special tax incentive will be accounted for. So you'll see how much money is not coming into the budget from those tax breaks. That's a really big win for us. That's something that Orion has been advocating for, other groups that want transparency. It just helps us see, is this a good economic development strategy? Do we like the way this money is going? And, you know, are we missing out on some revenue that we need?
Can I mention something here, Robyn? I was looking at numbers in the general fund yesterday, and I had one of those aha moments. I was looking at the numbers, and it said that the corporate income tax was going down. It was expected to be $110 million this year. It was only going to be like $50 million, $60 million next year. And I thought, well, why? You know, I'm thinking those, I can't say it here because we're keeping our opinions to ourselves, right? But I had the good fortune to know the director of the Legislative Fiscal Office's email address, and he's interim director, and I sent him an email, and I said, why is this? What am I missing here? And he said, well, the reason that it was so high in fiscal year 15 is because there were some legal settlements that were, you know, some audit challenges. And so they took in a big hunk of money in fiscal year 15. So if I'm only, and I was only looking at 15 and 16, right? So this is where looking at numbers can be confusing. But it was good to know that there was a reason for that, because I thought it was a law passed that I missed that said they were going to lower corporate income tax, or corporate taxes is how it's looked at. But no, it's just that there was a big win, apparently. I don't know, the media didn't report on it, so I don't know who that was that, you know, had to pay a big hunk in corporate taxes. But that did come into the conference for fiscal year 15, won't be here for fiscal year 16. That would be something called non-recurring revenue, right? So anyway, yeah. I just thought that was interesting. The normal level is around 50 or 60 million.
Okay. Good to know.
Nobody's mentioned anything about the lid and its effect on taxes.
What?
The lid bill. It's an urban legend that's true. And Joe Adams could probably explain it better than any of us. It sets a cap on how much a city can tax itself in property taxes. Okay, and so in education circles, unless you're Mountain Brook or Vestavia, who were exempted from the lid bill because they were already above it when the bill was passed, you are challenged in how much local property tax you can raise. But again,
that puts the onus on the locals as opposed to what is the state handing out. So those, even if there were no lid bill, you're still allowing those who have the ability to raise the revenue to outraise those who can't. So in a tax fairness system, it would be more a property tax at the state level as opposed to allowing the individual communities to tax themselves. But it is a ceiling that superintendents bump into. You know, we've seen a lot of property tax votes go down in flames here lately of the local people not wanting to raise their own property taxes to fund schools, which is an interesting trend that has developed recently, which is why this sort of talk is also so timely. Anyway, I just wanted to address that.
Yeah, thank you. I didn't know that's what it was called.
That's what we refer to.
Yes.
Will you repeat that, Robyn? Because I don't know if the microphone can pick it up.
So they cannot give tax abatements for education taxes, like those property taxes that are earmarked and those sales taxes that are earmarked for education. That's and the income taxes.
Has Parka done any reporting on, Joe, has Parka done any reporting on these sorts of, have y'all been asked to, because I know that's why you do things, is because you're asked to do them, right?
Well, we did too, and I put them on the Facebook link on the announcements for this. There are two papers that I think are interesting. One is how do Alabama taxes compare, and then that piece, and I brought one paper copy just in case, but we look at how if you were taxed in Alabama, say at the rate that they do in Florida, how much more money would that bring in and so forth. But then we also have, and I don't want to get too far ahead, but we also have the results of our survey from this year, which asked the question about whether or not people are willing to pay more taxes, which I think is important as well. So,
and the answer was?
Generally, yes, for certain things. And so it's important to recognize that as well. But, you know, there are certain limitations, and we've got 890 amendments to the Alabama Constitution. So many of them revolve around raising the taxes in particular county. And
yeah.
So we have these very specific provisions like Constitutional Amendment 458, which limits the taxes on trucks in Pike County. And so if you get those kinds of carve-outs and so forth in the process of how these taxes are actually passed.
Yes. Do y'all actually count the number of amendments?
Well, I think there are 892, but when we worked on the one that set the minimum at 10 mils, and that was Constitutional Amendment 778, that was in 2006.
My dad is Bill Stewart, that's retired professor of Alabama politics at the University of Alabama. If you watch the news or who came to read, you'd see his comments. And he's actually working on a book he's revising the figure on the Alabama Constitution. And the figure he gives is usually around 900. He's an expert on the Alabama Constitution. He doesn't know how many amendments there are, which suggests to me it's there's a problem there with the Constitution. But the question I do have, if you're, you make, you've talked a lot about earmarks, and are you going to kind of be discussing at all kind of how you know, Alabama compares in terms of, you know, the stuff that we earmark versus other states in terms of levels?
Yeah, so just to summarize, we had some comments about the state constitution and what it limits in terms of taxes and how many of them does. And our earmarks, the question is, how do we measure up to other states? We earmark over 90% of our revenue for specific needs. Most states, it's only around 30 to 40%, I think, is the figure. So when it comes time to move money around, they're very limited. Their hands are tied. We have amendments, like in our constitution, we made it against the law to use the gas tax for anything but roads, which, you know, it's great. Gas tax should be used for roads, but most states use the gas tax to fund public transit, and now we have no way to raise funding for public transit. So yeah, our earmark situation is out of control. I actually have a brief video that I can show, but I want to wrap up soon so we have enough time to discuss solutions. And this book goes like way more in depth on, you know, how do property taxes work? If you're like me, I've never actually paid property taxes, except that I rent. So
you do pay property tax through your landlord.
I don't have to write the check.
That's right. That's a common.
This explains what a mill is and all of this stuff. And our book has solutions and ways we can make each of these taxes more equitable, more adequate, more just, and more transparent. Okay, but back to businesses. Businesses and corporations in Alabama pay a lot less in total taxes than they do in other states. Compared to other states, our property tax is very low. Sales tax is about the same. Excise, utility, we're actually higher on. But everything else, well, and also our licenses and fees and stuff are higher here. And that comes from the idea that, well, we need to raise money somewhere, let's raise more money through licenses and fees.
It's not a tax.
Yeah, so it's not a tax, it's a fee.
Right.
I'm just going to share with you what I was, years ago, economics at the University of Alabama, my econ teacher, I said, why the property taxes so low? This is urban economics. He said in two words, pine trees.
Yes, so pine trees in Alabama, live a much more luxurious life than most of us and pay much less taxes than any of us ever will, because large tracts of land that are owned by timber companies are taxed about, I think, 25% of what they would be taxed in other states. So yeah, we're missing out on a huge portion of property tax right there. There's other suggestions to find revenue. The reason that a lot of corporations don't pay income taxes in the state is because we don't do combined reporting. So if you're Walmart and your headquarters is out of state, you don't have to declare any income for the state of Alabama. You can say, oh, it's all income for this, our headquarters in this other state. A lot of states have passed laws to combine your reporting, and that's another solution to raise more revenue. And I think Trisha's going to wrap us up with some big picture questions, but again, this book has a lot more details than I do.
Yeah. Yay, Robyn. There's a lot more information about the general fund than I've known, and I appreciate that. I think, you know, we are hodgepodge of taxes. We do earmark a lot of stuff. There is very little flexibility, so when one tax is down for the year, then that whoever's earmarked for that money is in trouble, right? So that's the simple way to put it. And I did plagiarize this picture from Google, but because I can't draw very well. I could have asked family members who draw very well. But so my analogy is the blanket, meaning taxes, is the blanket big enough to cover the bed, right? We've all tried to put, or maybe I'll just like, I've tried to make a twin blanket fit a queen bed, right? Or I get the wrong set of sheets out to change. And so you're constantly tugging over here and pulling over there, and then that side doesn't have enough covers, and so you pull it over there.
And that's the way I see what we're doing with taxes. I'm not saying that anything isn't worth funding, and I'm not making any statement about raising taxes. If we like the way we do things, if we like readjusting the blanket and tugging on it over here and then running to the other side and tugging on it over here, then that's okay. You know, I mean, but that's what we get to decide as people, right? That's what we get to decide as voters, theoretically. So at this was the best way I could figure this out to show this graphically. You know, if you've got a twin size blanket, it really doesn't cover you if you're on a king size bed. And I don't know where we are in that stack. I don't know where our taxes stack up versus our needs, but something, all I hear is that we need more money or we need to cut back. So it's not, those things are not equal. What we're bringing in and what we need to spend are not equal. And so either we cut on the spending side or we raise on the other side. All right, so solutions on the table very quickly because we're over time and I apologize, but I really enjoy this very casual exchange where we can take some time to answer questions and bring experiences. Any solutions that you're hearing about are going to change, likely to change. When they get back into their second special session for the year, for this year, to pass this general fund budget, there are going to be a whole lot of people with a whole lot of hope. Wait, in an ideal world, there would be a whole lot of people with a whole lot of solutions on the table. And what I'm hearing, if you watch Capital Journal on HGTV is a great, great source to hear what your legislators are saying. Or pick up the phone and call them and ask them, how are you going to solve this? Call your House member,
yeah,
call your
they
senator.
They would love to hear that question.
Yeah, just ask them, because what they tell us is that no one is, what they're saying is no one's calling. There was one senator, Senator Chambliss out of Prattville, who went on on Capital Journal and said he had 500 people who said raise taxes, and he had 6 people who said cut spending. So, you know, he said, I am hearing from the people. Now, he is in Prattville, which is right outside of Montgomery, and maybe they make more phone calls.
I called him.
There you go.
I live in Trisha County. He's mine. I called him.
Okay, that's great.
I think they're getting phone calls. They're just not answering the phones.
Oh, okay. Well, there's email, there's snail mail, there's telephone. There's telephone. I think that we can engage them in this conversation. I'll tell you, I have a calls. I sometimes feel my hands are tied as the executive director of a media organization, that I can't really ask personal questions like that or display my thoughts. But this is our contact information, which you can certainly get from us as well while you're here. And I want to just make one quick statement that the next meeting of the Education Matters Group will be the last Sunday of the month at Hoover Public Library. We haven't picked a topic, so anything's on the table. One might emerge, kind of like it did now. You know, we had some folks trying to find us a meeting place for this month's meeting, and Robyn came in last week and said, hey, if you ever find a meeting place, we can do it at the Beloved Community Church. And I was like, yeah, let's talk about money. Now, that was a topic. If you go to the Allen School Connection website and go to the Education Matters, it's menu item, you get to vote on what topic you'd like to see covered in one of these meetings. And so the idea is to bring in folks who have the expertise, who are willing to stay nonpartisan, and I think you did a beautiful job, because I know that ARISE does have a lot of solutions that they advocate for, and I appreciate that you helped us with our deliberative atmosphere here. If you make sure that you take one of these, and for those of you on the internet, you can, there are order forms, you can order a printed copy, or you can just download a PDF and save some trees, right? So be sure to get one of these. This is terribly informative, and I choose those words very carefully. Terribly informative, okay? Mm-hmm. We need to understand how we tax, and we need to understand how we spend, because it is our money. You might not be paying property taxes directly to but you're paying sales taxes, right? I might be paying property taxes, but not a whole lot of sales taxes these days. You know, it just sort of depends on where your income level is, right? But everybody's paying taxes. And so we can use the information. I hope that you use some of the information that you've learned here. Talk to your friends in the supermarket, in the church, at the ballpark, at lunch. Talk about this stuff, you know, because if we all learn this information and then we just sit on it, then it doesn't really do any good. My hope is that we'll go out into the community and, you'll talk to your younger friends and say, y'all know those things going on down in Montgomery, and I learned some stuff, and you know, it's your opportunity to get folks engaged in this discussion, because right now that discussion is mostly happening in a vacuum.
So we should pick this up and take it to the Sidewalk Film Festival and get a booth.
Sure, yes, I'll be entering this next year's competition for this act. No, I won't. But anyway, so I want to say thank you again to Robyn. And what we're going to do is stick around and have a conversation for anybody who wants to. I think we have to leave by
6 is when our church starts. So y'all welcome to stay for church, and we have a potluck supper after.
But oh, that's nice.
We can be here
for that invitation.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to turn the internet off, and we're going to have whatever discussion y'all want to have. I've promised to cook dinner tonight. My son is coming home for dinner tonight, so I have to leave not too long because I have to remember how to cook. So thank you very much. Does anybody have anything that they want to say before we wrap up our internet broadcast?
Thank you, Alabama School Connect.
Yay. And Joe, thank you for being here because it's, you know, I said I want to be Parker when I grew up. But I think I'm almost grown, and I might have missed my opportunity. So I appreciate all that Parker does for us. You give us some back.
We have a wonderful study on pre-K.
Yes,
and that might be a topic that might be looking to universal voluntary pre-K. And Parker was actually in the lead in their study. Other studies have followed, but I didn't think that Parker was actually the first to kind of break the ice on that issue.
Well, and for the viewing people, Parka has great studies, which I hope we can talk about do people want to raise taxes for these needs, and is our tax system fair?
So. I will put those links, go to alabamaschoolconnection.org for those of you with internet connections, and then see the education matters in the menu, and I will put those links there. We will house them there, and we will continue to communicate via meetup.com, which is kind of fun, and Facebook and the website. So until next month, thank you again, Mr. Fulton, for our donuts. That was all.